Non funziona.
Sì, ma non su questo video. Non è.
Vabbè, ok, che faccio è quello.
La bacchetta è qua. Non l'ha messa?
Ok. Ok, so it's a pleasure to be here. It's an honor to celebrate this passion for particles. I think I'm one of probably the least distinguished speakers, so I want to thank the organizers, especially Enrico Trincherini, for the invitation. So I will say something about Riccardo later on, but let's get to the point. So I want to talk about these couple of papers that I've been working on. It's about Galileans that I will describe what they are, but more general about dilatons, that is to say representation of the nonlinear representations of the conformal group. Okay, maybe I should stress my PhD students, Gabriele Trevisan, all the others are well known to the audience. Let me start with some motivation. So why one should be interested in Galileans? I think this year in cosmology we made a big step forward. Planck results, among many things, they showed a deviation from scale invariance at 5 sigma level, which is some sort of psychological threshold, but it's also an important threshold. What does it mean? So you're probably familiar with this kind of plot. On the vertical axis there is the contribution of gravitational waves in primordial gravitational waves. This is still an upper bound, so we didn't learn much from this side. On the horizontal axis, there is what is called the scalar tilt. What does it mean, a tilt? Tony was talking about these primordial perturbations that evolve to form structures. The initial conditions are Gaussian, so are characterized by two-point function. And the two-point function is approximately scale invariant. Scale invariant in cosmology means 1 over k cube. That is to say, in real space, is just the two-point function is a log of the distance. So this is a good approximation, but as you see from the plot, is not valid anymore, because at 5 sigma level, 1, which is scale invariant, is ruled out. And why this is important? Well, it's important because scale invariance was, it's not a prediction of inflation. Actually, it was invented in the 70s by Harrison and Zeldovich, and it is just the first thing that you can think. So it's just the simplest fit to what you see in the sky. So it was just not really theoretically justified. So now, to see a deviation from this means that first of all, it's kind of a prediction of inflation, so it tells you that there is something dynamical. It tells you that inflation is a period of expansion of the universe, but later on it will finish. So you need something dynamical, so you need a deviation from scale invariance. So this, I think, is a big step, probably the biggest step after we saw the peaks like 10 years ago. Okay. So can we say now that inflation is proven? So can we give the Nobel Prize? Can we say that we discovered the Higgs in 2012, and maybe we discovered the inflaton in 2013? Well, I'm not sure. There are still reasonable alternatives in the market, okay, which are not surely as compelling as inflation. On the other hand, compelling is not the end of the story. At the end, for example, Technicolor was very compelling, but it's not true. So I don't want to describe these kind of scenarios. I just want to mention that, just to have an idea of what kind of scenario one can have in mind, one can have in mind what is called a bouncing universe, that is to say, a universe in which the scale factor contracts until it reaches a minimum and then starts expanding. Okay. And the reason why these kind of scenarios is not so easy to realize is that to make a bounce is difficult. You need a very special kind of stress energy tensor, one that violates a relation, which is called the null energy condition. K is a null vector, okay? It's an inequality, which in the FRW context means that the Hubble rate is a decreasing function of time. Okay? So this means that if you have this inequality, you cannot realize a bounce, because in the bounce, H must change its sign. Okay? So why this is related to Galileans? Because Galileans, and this is one of the strange features of these theories, they can realize a violation of an analogy condition in a way which is stable and healthy, in some sense. Okay, this is one motivation why maybe you can be interested in these theories, which are sort of interesting on their own, in the sense theoretically interesting. So, these are the motivations. So, I will first of all explain that Galileans, in some sense, are close parents, actually are dilatons. So, we're talking about nonlinear representations of the conformal group. And I will remind you that we are used to two way of representing the conformal group. And I will talk about the mapping between these two representations. Okay? And so there is a complicated mapping between the two. But eventually, I will argue that based on constraints coming from supernormality, we will understand that these two representations, in some sense, are physically different. So, which is kind of strange. Usually, we are used to think that the way you represent a coset, the way you represent, so you give me a symmetry breaking pattern, I don't care, you use the fields that you like, the representation that you like, the physics will be the same. This will be some sort of an exception to this, probably related to the fact that we're talking about a space-time symmetry. Galileans. Two of the authors are in the audience, so I'm not very qualified to talk about Galileans. But so, what is a Galilean? A Galilean is a scalar with a symmetry, which is not a shift symmetry, but also a shift of the derivative. So d mu pi goes into d mu pi plus a constant vector b mu. And why it's called Galilean, this symmetry? Well, because in if you think about one-dimensional, mechanics. The shift, a Galilean shift of velocity is x dot goes in x dot plus a constant, okay? So in one dimension is the same as this, so that's why it's called Galilean invariance. And what are the lowest dimension operators compatible with this symmetry? Well, you expect that in the equation of motion you have two derivatives, because you want a shift under one derivative. And at the Lagrangian level, the lowest dimension operators have this form. Once we take the equation of motion, you get n minus 1, so you get equation of motion which are functions of two derivatives. Of course, you can always add more derivatives, and these are the lowest dimension operators. These theories are sort of interesting because, first of all, are constrained. There are only five operators in four dimension, okay? So these are these. Of course, the first one is the kinetic term, because we know that this is what happens in mechanics, but there are more complicated things. This is related to the DGP model, if you know what it is, and there are five in total. I told you that the Galilean is related to the conformal group, to a dilaton, and the reason, the statement is that the Galilean group, so Poincaré plus these symmetries, is just a contraction of the conformal group, so it's a limit of the conformal group. You can see it because this is the nonlinear, this is the transformation of a dilaton under dilation and special conformal transformations. So there is these are the usual conformal transformations. So you see that in the limit in which pi is small, so pi is much smaller than 1, so I can drop this term and drop these terms, and you're back to the symmetries I was talking about, a shift and a shift by something proportional to x mu. Okay? So it's so the Galilean is a limit, if you want, of the dilaton, okay? And that's why now I want to talk about dilatons, nonlinear realizations of the conformal group. So how do we, if we ever thought about dilatons, what is the way we write a Lagrangian for a dilaton? Okay. One simple way is to use to take an effective metric. So there is no dynamical gravity in this talk. So it is just I call it g mu nu, this Minkowski metric times e to the 2 pi. And I write operators which are diff-invariant with respect to this metric. And it's easy to realize that in this way, I I give rise to a Lagrangian which is which is non-linearized conformal group because a conformal transformation of the metric can be compensated by a movement, a shift of the dilaton. And this gives rise to conformal Galileans, in a sense a particular set of operators that you can write are the so-called conformal Galileans, which are the same as Galileans but under this extended algebra. They are complicated, so I just write the first, but I just want to stress that they can be written in terms of invariant of this metric, the curvature. Here there is a cubic polynomial of the Ricci tensor. Okay, I don't want to enter, this term cannot be written because it's the best domino term, but it's not relevant for our discussion. So this is one way to write operators which non-linearize the conformal group. But we are also used to another representation of the conformal group because many of us worked in some way or another in ADS EFT, and we know that ADS has the isometries of the conformal group, and we know also that if we put a brain or an extended object in ADS, this will non-linearize these isometries because it will break spontaneously the isometries of ADS. And okay, maybe you never noticed, but this way of non-linearizing SO4,2, the conformal group, is not the same as I was discussing before. And you can check it because if you call Q the modulus describing the brain, you can check that there is an extra term which is different from the previous slide. Okay, so it's slightly different. Okay, you say okay, it's okay. Okay, it's slightly different, and people also wrote Galileans in this representation. You can do it writing geometrical quantities on the brain. For example, you write the extrinsic curvature, the tension, and higher order terms, which are more complicated, okay, like Lovelock invariants. And for example, you see that these are different from the other ones. For example, the simplest term is the usual DBI action for a brain. Okay, so these are invariant, they non-linearize SO4,2, but in a way which is different from the previous one. So there are two representations, the Weyl and the DBI representation, so that I call. So at a certain point we ask, okay, but are these two representations physically the same? There is a theory definition, what it is? So you can ask, are they related? What happens to the Galileans, given that I was interested in these theories? And in particular, do they give the same physics at the end? So are they just the same theories in disguise or are different? Okay, so as it always the case, once you find a question, you will find out that some Russian already did it. And so in this case, there are also but anyway, Ivanov is an expert of his non-linear representations of groups. So we found that, but of course you don't understand the answer. So you have the paper, but then you don't understand the answer until you find an easier way to get to the same result. But of course the result is correct. So not. Okay, so what is the standard? The standard way to approach the problem is using the same as CCWZ, the systematic way of writing a non-linearly realized symmetries. So in this case, it's slightly more complicated because the group does not commute with Lorentz, so I have also to take the coordinates into account. But it's not so different than what you do with pions. So you have a group, and it's you have a certain representation of the coset, and you realize that the two representations, the ADS, the DBI, and I call it DBI, the second representation, and the Weyl one, are related by the fact that there is a twist, in some sense, between the conformal generator and translations. Okay, so it's a different representation of the coset. Okay, it's straightforward, but super complicated to find what is the relation between the two. So at the end, you end up with this. The relation between the two representations, pi is the dilaton in the Weyl representation, q is the dilaton in the DBI representation, are related by this, where lambda is given by this thing. And there is also, and this is the crucial point, there is also a change of coordinates. So although there is no dynamical gravity, to related to, there is also a change of coordinates, which comes from the fact that, of course, coordinates do not mix with the conformal algebra. Okay, this was complicated, but at the end, there is also a much easier way to get to the same result, and this actually was inspired by Riccardo and Alberto, that I think here in Scuola Normale they studied the same problem. So we just extended what they did at the nonlinear level, but at the linear level they already did it. The idea is to look at this transformation between the two representations as a change of coordinates in ADS. In what sense? I told you that one of the representation is the one of an extended object parameterized by Q of X in ADS. Now you can also change gauge, and it's pretty complicated, but to do it nonlinearly it's pretty complicated, but it's straightforward, to go to a gauge in which the brain is at fixed position, okay, is straight. In doing this change, you are going to change the metric, of course, of ADS. You're going to end up with a complicated metric that I don't write, but what is important is that you induce a conformal factor on the boundary of ADS, and it turns out that this pi is the pi of the Weyl representation. Not surprisingly, because the conformal factor on the boundary will transform in the Weyl way, while this Q of X transform in the DBI way, okay? So this is a much easier way to get to the same result. And then it also illuminates some point, because the other question that I want to ask is, what happens to these Galileans, okay? So there are these five Galileans on one side, five Galileans on the other. If you look, it's not clear what happens, because this transformation is very complicated, and there is no reason to expect that Galileans go to Galileans, unless you take this five-dimensional point of view, because I remind you that Galileans, they have the property to have second-order equation of motions, and this statement cannot depend on the gauge, and we saw that the change between the two representations is a change of gauge. So the bottom line is that actually Galileans are mapped into Galileans, with a matrix Riccardo. Well, this, why? In the sense, this. But I mean, you're doing a, forget about the five-dimensional picture. So you have a change of coordinates which contains an infinite number of derivatives. So you would expect to generate operators with more derivatives, but you don't. Okay, so it's a matrix like this. What is slightly interesting is that this matrix is generic, is complicated. So this means that even if I start with a very simple term on one side, for example, the kinetic term, like e to the minus 2 pi d pi squared, I go in the other mapping, on the other side, I generate all the five Galileans. If I start with just a DBI action on one side, I go to the Weyl side, I generate all the five Galileans. Okay? So from this point of view, it tells you that Galileans maybe are not so crazy, in the sense that they appear naturally if I change the representation of the conformal group. But okay, that's fine, but it looks not very interesting, because at the end, okay, it's a very complicated theory definition, but at the end, if, okay, let's maybe consider the coordinates to be the same, so let's move this inside here, so I can expand Q of X plus this in derivative. So it's a complicated infinite theory definition, but at the end, it will give the same S matrix, because it's a complicated theory definition. But, and indeed, you can check that for very simple examples, you get the same X matrix. But it's not the end of the story, because at a certain point, you run into problems with the superluminarity. Let me remind you why we're interested in superluminarity. Superluminarity, following, for example, this paper by Riccardo, Nima, and friends, has been used to check whether a theory, an effective theory, is healthy, in the sense that it admits a standard local Lorentz invariant UV completion. In what sense? Well, if you have a theory, for example, let's consider this theory, and you consider a background of the scalar pi, you would expect in a healthy theory that the speed of propagation inside in a given region in which there is a background acts like a sort of refraction index, but diminishing the speed of light, not making it larger than one. And indeed, you can check that this must be the case, and this constrains the operators, some sign or some operators. For example, in this Lagrangian, this C3 must be positive. In this Lagrangian, for a U1 field, C1 and C2 must be positive, and so on and so forth. So it's a constraint that you can use to check whether your theory is healthy or not. Okay, then we can use it for Galileans. And for Galileans, this is a well-known problem of DGP on of other theories. We run into problems because, so let's look at this term, which is the cubic Galilean. So if I consider a background, which is a solution of the free, let's consider, for example, a background around a point source, okay, which satisfies Laplacian of pi 0 equal to 0. Then I look at propagation of signals in this background, and I can check that there is an effective metric, which is Minkowski plus a correction, and the problem is that this correction is not positive definite, so it will have some direction in which there is a propagation which is faster than light. And this is a problem of the theory. Now, this was confusing for us because what you can find is that if you start with a super healthy theory on one side and you do this theory definition, you end up in a theory which you would rule out using this criterion. So we were a bit confused, especially, I don't want to enter into details, but for these scenarios that I was talking at the beginning for primordial cosmology, it was very confusing because you obtain completely different answers about this supernormality. Okay. Let me solve. I mean, of course, it's easier to go back to Galileans. I mean, it's just a technical. This is just a technical simplification. So I told you that we started from Galileans. We went to the conformal group because it was maybe more interesting. But of course, everything is more complicated. So at the end, I told you that I can do a contraction. So pi going to zero or q going to zero. In this limit, I go back to Galileans. So now I have a mapping between Galileans and Galileans because I do this contraction on both sides. Okay. So this just simplifies a bit the algebra and was recently also discovered with other means by another group. So in this case, the simplest example that I can imagine is I have a free theory, d pi squared. I do this complicated free definition, I end up with the five Galileans, okay? And this theory, if I apply the same argument as before, is superluminal because it has this cubic operator. It has a correction to the speed of light, which is given by this ratio, which I consider it to be small. I can do it also, it is just to simplify the algebra, okay? Okay, so what's going on? Well, I mean, it's not so surprising. At the end, it has to do with the fact that the theory definition is infinite and non-local. So even if the S matrix, if I calculate an S matrix perturbatively at a certain order, I will truncate my theory definition and I will get the same result in the two theories. But superluminality knows more, in some sense, because it's... I mean, when I say that a signal propagates superluminally, it means that I have a solution with this correction to the speed of light, which is, I can trust this solution, so I'm not expanding in this, you know? I can trust the whole exponential, so I'm making a statement which is not perturbative in delta CS, okay? And so you can ask, when is this effect measurable within the effective field theory? It is measurable when the correction to the speed of light, which I told you is given by this, times the propagation of the signal becomes of order of the wavelength. Okay. This implies this relation. And in this regime, what is the important point is that in this regime, the theory definition that I was telling you cannot be expanded, because going back, this theory definition, you see, it's of this form. So when I plug this inside Q, the expansion parameter is two derivatives acting on Q, but when superluminality is measurable, this becomes of order one, so I cannot expand it. So the bottom line is that there are questions that I can ask to the theory for which I need the full theory definition, which is non-local, and so that the two theories are really inequivalent when I get to this point. So, okay, I can skip. We did a few checks. At the end, what you can see is that if I couple my field with a local source, okay, so I start, for example, with a local coupling of this kind, it becomes an ugly beast on the other side. But okay, if I can still truncate it, it's still complicated, but still local. The point is that in the regime where it is in, I cannot truncate it, and it becomes a fully fledged non-local coupling. Okay, so the bottom line is that it's true. These theories are related one to the other, but they are related in a non-local way. So at the end, for all practical purposes, they are inequivalent. And it's not surprising that the conclusion that you draw on the UV completion is different. Okay, so I didn't have time to talk about these scenarios, but let me recap. There are these two representations of the conformal group, which give rise to two different sets of Galileans. There is a complicated theory definition between the two, which, as you expect, preserve at least the perturbative S-matrix. But the fact that we are talking about a non-local theory definition matters in some cases, and in particular, it matters when I study superluminarity. And the bottom line is that this also tells you something about these neck-violating scenarios I was describing at the beginning, because it tells you that we can build solutions which are subluminal. Okay, so at least this is not a problem. Okay, I think. Can I say something about Riccardo? No, okay. So I want to thank Riccardo for sharing his passion for particles and for physics in general with us. So an anecdote. When you are a student and you get to your degree, usually your friends make a lot of fun of you, and they make a poster with a poem about you, with very heavy jokes. And there is also usually a picture of you, of course, making fun of you. And my friends wanted to pointing out the deep influence that Riccardo had on me in that period. And so this is what they wrote, and there is a Susi partner behind. Okay, that's, okay, thank you, Riccardo.
What's good about this conference that you made make fun of Riccardo without being punished at the spot? Okay, now if there are any questions, okay, you are the first, please.
One very simple. What happened to L, to the light propagation in your inequality? Disappeared.
Yes, what happens to L? No, I understand, sorry.
Because if you wait long enough, you get a measurable effect. No matter how small is the superluminality for any frequency.
So there are constraints basically. Yes, so, yeah, sorry, it was too quick. At a certain point, I make some approximation, so I make this small for a certain range. So if I can wait long enough, but then the solution changes. So, sorry, this uses the inequality that this approximation of a small variation of the speed of light remains small. So yes, sorry, I get to the point.
The second question was, you have two effects. You have a filter definition, where you go from one Galileo to the other. You also have a change of coordinates. You said that the change of coordinates, even though even it could be not local in itself, but that doesn't change the light.
No, no. If you want to describe it like this, no, it's much more trivial than you think. So it's the change of coordinates that changes the light cone. So if there is nothing deeper than this. On the other hand, I can. The paradox to me is that I would expect that if you give me the symmetry pattern, the two theories are equivalent. They are equivalent, but if you want, they are equivalent only if I'm willing to change coordinates or if you want to change the concept of locality. So at the end, they are not equivalent. Yeah. So it's not. Boundary conditions. So I prefer to say locality. Or I don't understand that. Yes, but why I prefer to talk about localities, in the sense you have to define what are the local operators. Maybe the same.
No, your second. Yes, you, please.
Correspondence, because the most direct way of thinking of the ADS-CFT correspondence is between is in terms of the equivalence of these two SO42 symmetries that are present, say, in N=4 context. So one says that somehow the isometry group in the bulk and the conformal group on the boundary are one and the same thing. And now you're stressing that, in fact, when you're mapping the variables precisely, there is a non-local transformation which can make certain statements a bit naive. I wonder whether this is a deeper point that you hit.
I'm not an expert. The only thing that I can say is that, as far as I understand, and the experts can correct me, so in the classical example of N=4, what happens is that at weak coupling, you have a non-linearization of the conformal group of the first kind, and then it's a sort of strong coupling effect, the fact that the realization of the conformal group that you read from ADS becomes different. So, but I don't know too much, and I didn't find. So Alberto, you look at me. So in the sense, so I think what he's asking is that the fact that you have this representation of the conformal group given by the ADS picture, is it known? In a sense, it's not the standard, the usual representation that you would imagine. So do you know it from the beginning that in N=4 you get this kind of representation or not?
So I don't know what is special for N=4, I guess. N=4 is just a realization of ADS-CFT, but I don't think that in that particular example will happen something different from what you have here.
Sorry, but also in that case, isn't the conformal group actually exact? You have full representations. There is no, you don't have a spontaneously broken.
No, I'm thinking about. I'm fitting putting something on the Coulomb branch and the spontaneous.
Yeah, but that's, of course, that's a strong coupling description.
But my confusion is that at weak coupling, if I put something on the Coulomb branch, I would expect the other representation. No, I would expect the Weyl representation. In the four-dimensional point of view, I take a weak coupled theory, move something, I don't expect to get this this DBI representation, which I get from the ADS-CFT strong coupling, so I don't know what happens in between. Sorry.
So you discover that there is this other completely unsuspected but equivalent, well, not equivalent, but representation with the condition that it maps second order equations of motion by a non-local field definition to again second order equations of motion.
Mm-hmm.
Expect that there would be a third representation of this kind, or you think there are only two?
Well, I guess if you read it from the ADS, probably there are others. So I mean, usually there are not only two, no. So. I don't know, but if you read it from the ADS, you would expect that maybe there are other gauges or other things that you can play, or I don't know.
I have a short comment and one short question. I have Mike, thank you. Comment is that the statement that spectrum of perturbations is not of Harrison-Zildovich, is not flat, which follows from Planck data, is model dependent. It depends, for example, with a model with some millicharged light, millicharged particles, it could be compatible with flat. By the way, it was in our paper, one of the co-authors was your co-author, Sergei Dubovsky. Okay, and the question is maybe my misunderstanding. When you speak about speed of light, what did you mean? Group velocity or front velocity?
Well, I think all these are, in a sense, in the theories I'm considering, there is no dispersion. In the sense, the dispersion relation is just omega in the limit in which this is a constant. We are just have the dispersion relation is omega equal to a constant times k. So I think in this case all the velocities I can define are the same. No. Mm-hmm. Okay, so. Okay.
Thank you. Let us thank the speaker again, and then we can.